Hey, yo, this Jeezy right now speaking to y'all. This the heart of the motherfucking city. Act like y'all ain't had that motherfucking Clips album and shit.
20 years in the game, talking about dope, straight up.
Act like y'all ain't based y'all whole shit, whole lifestyle off this nigga Pusha T.
That's what I do. Mm-hmm. Streets. Mm-hmm. That's what I cater to. That's what I talk to.
Everything is Pusha T.
That name, it carries so much. With that name, Pusha T, you know he's pushing a product.
I'm never on nobody's shot clock. Never.
This the only nigga spitting that wild motherfucking hip-hop shit right now. That's why I stand next to these niggas.
I'm not changing that for nobody. Everybody else, you know, they start dancing. I ain't do that.
I don't give a fuck about none of these corporations.
I'm not on anybody's time ever.
I want to talk to all you addicts out there that's got yourself a great big joint, and you done tried all the methadone, and you just can't leave that heroin alone. I wonder.
Terrence LeVar Thornton. That's my mother name. So she first. Pusha T. That's who I am. This music is personal. Like, it's super personal to me.
Pusha T has remained a rap favorite for over 16 years. Terrence Thornton, the former dealer turned rapper, has made quite the image for himself despite shaky beginnings. Being involved with a multi-million dollar trafficking operation, moving weight, and writing rhymes, Terrence and his brother Gene, known as No Malice, almost faced a bitter end.
Pressure was, it was about having things. It was about greed, it was about drugs.
I come home like $700.
At 15.
At 15.
And both had a skill for rapping about selling. And that combination made them millionaires.
Wait a minute. I'm on the MTV Awards. Like, people are calling me behind this.
Pusha and his brother Malice had been broken into the industry due to actual dealers booking them for private concerts. Their talent, coupled with the incredible production of the Neptunes, took the streets by storm. After they broke through the streets, their next home was in the budding age of music downloads.
But just as they were about to explode into superstar status, one of the brothers made the stunning choice to walk away.
With their best friends, including their manager, doing time for an illegal operation, it was time for the brothers to go their separate ways.
You know, it wasn't, and you know, people always say my manager, man. It was 9 of my best friends, not just my manager.
9 of your best friends?
Yeah.
What was the years?
A conspiracy.
Okay.
So, and it ranged from 10 to 34 years.
Try to
I mean, you know, it's really, it's an indictment.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. It's all public record at this point.
Mm-hmm. No Malice turned to the Lord, and Pusha went off to make his name in the rap game. After linking up with Kanye, being signed to Good Music, and serving as one of Kanye's close collaborators, Pusha had graduated far past what anyone could have imagined.
Right now! Right now! Right now, Kanye! Right now! It's not about hot fashion! It's about black t-shirts! And drums!
Now he's the president of Good Music, with a couple of strong albums under his belt. It's needless to say that anticipation was high for his next project. But then, 2 years came and went, with no album in sight. What was the holdup? Kanye West.
You know, I come back with a finished product, bring it to him like, look, I feel like this is my album. He was like, yeah, it's rocking. You know, so we rock for like 2 days. I stayed in LA for 2 days. Third day, he wake up, he was like, yo, man, I feel like I could produce these beats better myself. Just do it myself. Mm-hmm. Let's go to Utah.
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 Originally slated to be titled King Push, the album was changed to Daytona. Named after the Daytona Rolex, the title is meant to illustrate that Pusha and Kanye had a luxury that not everyone could afford.
It's about having the luxury of time. I'm never on nobody's shot clock. Never. Never.
Fans were left very skeptical when they saw that Pusha's album only had a track list of 7 songs. The use of 7 tracks counters the current trend in standard album releases, in which albums are longer than ever before. Because of streams counting towards album sales, stuffing an album with as many songs as you can to get a higher mass of numbers is a go-to strategy for many artists.
I wonder if Kanye's on his supreme mathematics. Is that what he's on? Why he wanted to go with 7?
Yo, I'm gonna agree with that.
You think he's
definitely
on his...
said, he definitely told me verbatim, yo, it's something about that number 7, man. I'm telling you. It's like, it's the God's number, man.
I didn't think Thank 7 you. Songs would be fulfilling.
Yeah.
But it is.
No, me neither. Big argument.
Really?
Huge argument. We go out there. We out there the first day, you know, chef eating, you know, kicking it.
And, you know, one day turns into 10 days and ain't no beat.
The actual chopping and samples, that's where he's home at.
Yeah.
You know, he listening to samples every day, you know, feverishly.
I feel like that was his main objective, to make sure that it was just one sonic mood board. He literally did every beat top to bottom, right?
Okay.
Then one beat comes, The Games We Play.
And even when the album was finished, Kanye's perfectionism couldn't let it be. There was a photograph.
He told me about the artwork. You know, once I mentioned that to my team, they said, listen, the artwork is $85,000. I hit them back, bro, I don't want to pay for this.
We're not doing that.
It's too much.
I feel it, though.
The genius of this art is that upon first look, many don't notice that it was a repurposed photograph of Whitney Houston's bathroom, where an array of drugs and other paraphernalia are scattered all over the counter. Once the media caught wind of whose bathroom was in the picture, reactions were mixed. Was it tasteless? Was there a greater message? And was it necessary?
So, you know, basically he's like, listen, I'ma cover it. I really feel like you're the first project that's coming out of all the projects.
It's gotta set the tone.
It's gotta set the tone.
Yep.
The image depicts both the highs and lows of the drug life. On one hand, this was well before Miss Houston died. She was a celebrity being able to buy the best quality product at her whim. It begins luxurious, but it ends with far less dignity. And in the same image, it shows us that drugs really have ravaged our community. No matter how many clever similes are written or metaphors put together, there is always the darkness at the center.
Something has a hold on you. Something from within.
If you had to name the devil for you, the biggest devil among them,
that would be me. It's my deciding. It's my heart. It's what I want and what I don't want. Nobody makes me do anything I don't want to do. It's my decision. So the biggest devil is me. I'm either my best friend or my worst enemy.
Any young kid growing up in the hood, just wanting to have money, I remember serving one of my people, and the kids were asking their mom for food, and she told them that she didn't have any money, yet I knew the transaction that we had just made.
She was giving their food money to you.
Yeah, she was.
To buy a rock or two.
There are few artists like Pusha and Jay-Z who can really speak on it firsthand with the level of detail that they do. It's not all money and smiles. It's friends dead, friends locked up, addicts ravaged. The music is a lot bleaker than a lot of hip-hop albums this year.
One time, somebody had owed me some money. Uh-huh. Me and a couple guys got into a scuffle, and the guy came back and shot in front of my parents' home. So when she came home and she hears about all this, she's like, wait a minute, what you mean somebody owed you money? It was very, very disappointing.
Yeah.
Very disappointing. And like, into my dad, like, you know, it was one of them things where I was like, man, I can't ever make them feel like that again.
I really look at drugs and how drugs destroyed the community. It's sort of shaky ground with me. Like, I have literally one of my idol, person I looked up to, become addicted to like 19 or 20 years old.
You're talking about your brother.
Yeah. Somebody I look at, like, who I think is the freshest ever. Somebody taught me how to tie my shoes right, the cool way though, not your parents' way. And I'm just desensitized on the effects of what can go on in the community. I'm desensitized, I really am. At a certain point, man, I just feel like people are gonna do what they're gonna do.
One thing that has always been sure for an artist like Pusha is how he takes pride in the craft of songwriting. A rapper couldn't get away with rapping about the same content for so many years without impeccable writing.
You get a lot of heat from people who say you only rap about cocaine.
I don't care what they say. Listen, people can't even talk to me about that anymore.
Did I strike a chord?
Yeah, because that bothers me.
All right, let's go.
Because if you say that, then you only listening like at a surface level, number one. And I don't make my music for people who listen at a surface level. Gym star, razor, and a dinner plate. I just don't. I feel like it's a lot of similes, metaphors. I mean, it's an art to what I do. White on white, that's the tester. Black on black, that's the Tesla. I've been living with that stigma since I came out. And now I watch. I mean, we've now created a whole trap. A thon. Around dope boys and da 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 da. I mean, the backpackers are trapped out.
Yes.
All types of people are gravitating towards this music, this content. I ain't hearing none of that at this point. None
they
of
love
it.
It's a like, genre. They love
it's
it.
It's a whole genre.
Trap.
We it made a whole trap. Genre.
It's not just about selling drugs for Push. He also sees the metaphors of dealing and applies it to a hustling mentality. He's showing us that rap is his new hustle and a product of his dedication to quality. It's a saga about the guy who went straight, the old myth in gangster movies of getting out of a dark lifestyle and making something light out of it. His persona and work embody so much at once.
To all of my young niggas, I am your ghost in your raid. This is my purple tape.
Only Built for Cuban Links by Raekwon featuring Ghostface is like the holy grail of rap albums to me. And I was trying to make this album be as close as that as I could get it. If you know, you know.
The opening track is a manifesto explaining who this project is for. Pusha is acknowledging that only those from his background will be able to understand all of the ins and outs of his music.
My bass is my bass, and they love it, and they love me for it.
The sample comes from a 1972 song called 12 O'Clock Sataniel by Air. The rock sample drones throughout the track with a menacing rhythm. Kanye makes sure to rely heavily on the bass line in the sample to serve as a through line for the rest of the song. Booker T. Eberhardt's 1968 song Heart and Soul serves as a rhythmic and soulful instrumental. Fast-paced and full of energy, the song exhibits a completely different nature when slowed down. The song now had attitude and a heavy swagger. The swing on the beat is violent, and Pusha even sneaks in a word-for-word line from Jay-Z's Politics as Usual, paying homage to the hustler who came before him. The 1970 song High as Apple Pie, Slice 2, was a track by Charles Wright and the Watts 103rd Street Rhythm Band. The pianos and skittering hi-hat provide a luxurious backdrop for Push and Rick Ross to muse about maneuvering through the business.
The wordplay and the type of verbiage that you and Ross construct your rhymes is very, it's like cousins.
Yeah, yeah.
It's very expensive rap.
Luxury.
It's luxury.
Luxury rap.
The world famous Tony Williams accents the song with a soaring chorus.
I wanna talk to all you addicts out there that's got yourself a great big Jones.
The sound of a preacher trying to give the gospel to desperate addicts is interrupted by Pusha's sneering retelling of a new drug shipment. The juxtaposition is brutal. The opening sermon is sampled from a track called The Truth Shall Make You Free by the Mighty Hannibal. George Jackson's I Can't Do Without You serves as a spiritually soothing hook to give us time to catch our breath from the street life. Before Pusha dips us right back in again.
Santeria. Santeria. Santeria.
The dark track named after the darker religious practice sampled Lil' Kim's Drugs.
A different kinda.
And featured a refrain in Spanish from new artist 070 Shake. The song is Pusha venting about the death of his friend Davon, who was killed in a stabbing.
The Lord is my shepherd. Sheep.
It is a song of loss and pain.
Niggas talking shit, Push, how do you respond?
In What Would Meek Do? A song that has Pusha and Kanye marinating on ways to get back at their enemies. We have the track open with an ominous drone. The melody is dark and lifted from the 1971 song Heart of the Sunrise by Yes. The drone serves as the backbone for the rest of the track. The title is an homage to Meek Mill, as Pusha's devil on his shoulder asks him, what would Meek do when faced with adversity? Daytona's final track, a menacing song titled Infrared, came out of the gate with a ghostly presence.
Infrared, yeah, you know what I mean?
A song dedicated to calling out the falsehoods of the industry, it was the track that served as the response to Drake's song, Two Birds, One Stone. In Drake's track, he accuses Pusha of not really selling drugs like that, Pusha clapped back with a dig at Drake's ghostwriting allegations.
It was written like Nas, but it came from Quentin.
The reaction ballooned into a much publicized beef that the culture is still reacting to. But the song was Pusha reiterating his hustler spirit, not being dependent on drug money or rap money, illustrating himself as a smart businessman who knows how to move through this industry. And with that came his disdain for Drake's ghostwriting claims. Drake questioned Pusha's authenticity, and Pusha's track questioned Drake. Infrared serving as the album's closer serves to solidify Pusha's place among the best in the rap game. It was an exclamation point at the end of an already awe-inspiring statement.
I really have a masterpiece. Coined a masterpiece classic by the GOATs.
Yep.
Daytona.